Joining me now is Senator Ted Cruz. Senator, thanks for joining me. It's great to have you.
Samantha, great to be with you.
Now, you have a new book out about the Supreme Court. It's called One Vote Away, How a Single Supreme Court Seat Can Change History. Perfect timing, given the fact that we are just days away from Amy Coney Barrett's confirmation hearing. Now, before we get into that, I want to ask about this question that continues to go unanswered, whether or not the Biden administration will pack the court if they win in November.
Now, you've refused to answer the question. Joe Biden has refused to answer the question. So I think the American people would really like to know, if Judge Amy Coney Barrett is confirmed to the Supreme Court of the United States, are you and Joe Biden, if somehow you win this election, going to pack the Supreme Court to get your way?
Why do you think the Biden campaign has refused to answer this question about whether or not they will pack the court? And what will Republicans do if Democrats do indeed try to pack the court?
Well, I think the reason they won't answer it is because their answer is yes, and they know that's incredibly unpopular. So they're trying to hide just how radical their agenda is. It was striking last night at the vice presidential debate. I think the vice president did a terrific job. And four times he tried to nail Kamala Harris down on just give us an answer to this. And she refused. She ran for the hill. Run away. I'm not going to answer. Joe Biden did the same thing a week ago, debating the president. The reason is the Democrats right now, they're extreme. They're radical. They are ready to pack the court. If they win, if they take a majority, if we have Biden, Schumer, and Pelosi in charge, I believe they will pack the court. And they recognize that's not what the American people want. So they're trying to hide that from the voters.
Now, there's also been talk in recent months that the Biden administration would end the filibuster. What would you do if that were to happen?
Well, unfortunately, I think the chances of their ending the filibuster if they take control are 100%. Chuck Schumer, if he is Senate Majority Leader, within the first couple of months will end the filibuster. A majority can do that. If they have the votes, there's nothing the minority can do to stop it. It's called the nuclear option. It started when Harry Reid did it in 2013 and ended the filibuster for executive nominations and judicial nominations other than the Supreme Court. Republicans then, when the Democrats filibustered Neil Gorsuch, we ended the filibuster for Supreme Court nominations. And the final piece, and really by far the most consequential, is the filibuster for legislation. Historically, the filibuster has been the tool that the Senate minority does to stop the more radical agenda of whoever happens to be in power. Well, today, Senate Democrats, they are driven by the extreme left, by the Bernie Sanders, the Elizabeth Warrens, the AOCs, and I think they'd end the filibuster in a heartbeat. And if they have the votes, there's not a single thing that Senate Republicans could do to stop them. What we do to stop is beat them in November, because once they get the votes, there's no putting that genie back in the bottle.
Now, as I mentioned earlier, the confirmation hearings for Amy Coney Barrett start on Monday. And in the weeks leading up to this, we've seen attacks against her for the fact that she is a mother of seven. What do you make of these attacks, and what are you expecting to see during these hearings?
Well, I think the Democrats are out of their mind with rage about this vacancy, and that we're going to fill the vacancy. And I believe we are going to confirm Judge Barrett to the Supreme Court. And we're going to do so by the end of the month before Election Day. Part of the reason they are so upset, and this is something I talk about in my book, One Vote Away, is starting in the 1960s, the left made a conscious decision to that going through the democratic process was too hard. It was too complicated. The American people, when given a chance to vote on their radical agenda, tended to vote against it. And they made a decision to rely on the courts instead, that it was much easier to convince five unelected lawyers wearing robes to mandate the left-wing agenda than it was actually to do the messy process of democracy and convince your fellow Americans. The court is a source of power for the left. And so they were already, before Justice Ginsburg passed away, they were already filled with rage and fury at the president. They hate the president. But to borrow a line from Spinal Tap, now it goes to 11. They are even more upset. And so I expect at the confirmation hearing, I expect the same sort of political circus they subjected Justice Kavanaugh to. But as I said, at the end of the day, they're not going to succeed, and Judge Barrett's going to be confirmed.
Now, I just want to shift topics a little bit. Of course, we've already seen one presidential debate, and on Wednesday we had the first and only vice presidential debate. The Commission on Presidential Debates announced early Thursday that the next debate will be held virtually. Of course, Trump said that he would not be wasting his time on a virtual debate. You have debated President Trump on the stage before. Why do you think he's turning down this opportunity?
Well, I've debated President Trump many times. I actually spoke to him about it this morning. I agree with his decision. I think the Joe Biden does not want a debate. And I think the Presidential Debate Commission is basically behaving like an arm of the Biden campaign. I think we've seen it in the moderators. I think Chris Wallace did a terrible job. I think Susan Page was better, but she was still, it's an interesting question to ask. How many of the questions Susan Page asked last night would have read differently if they had been authored by the Biden campaign? And the answer is very few. It is absurd that every debate is moderated by a Democrat, which is what we have right now. It is also the idea of a virtual debate, which the commission just announced unilaterally without talking to anybody, serves only to protect Joe Biden. When there's serious questions about his competence, his mental acuity, whether he's up to it, giving him a chance to stay in his basement and hide from confrontation and have a teleprompter and aides all around him to assist him, that's not a debate. That is an effort to bail out the Biden campaign. And so I think the president was right to say, look, we need to have debates, have real debates instead of a staged event to make Biden look more effective than he is.
The November election is, of course, quickly approaching. We are less than a month out. And right now, President Trump's polls show him that he's trailing behind Joe Biden. Things could obviously change. Things could be completely different on election day. But if the election were held today, it doesn't really look good for the Trump administration. If the president does not win, what's next? How radical will the Biden-Harris administration be?
So I think the stakes have never been higher than they are right now. I think it is the extreme left that is driving the train. And I'm worried about the election. I'm worried about where we go. I'm worried about what I think a Biden-Schumer-Pelosi government would do more damage in 2 years than Barack Obama did in 8 years. I think they'd end the filibuster. I think they would have open borders. I think they'd pack the court. I think they'd admit two new states because they believe they'd get four new Democratic senators. I think they would raise taxes dramatically. I think they would implement the Green New Deal, which would bankrupt small businesses across the country and enrich Russia and Iran and Venezuela and our enemies across the globe. I think it is truly dangerous, the scope of the radical agenda they're pushing. And that's why we've got to win in November. I'm working tirelessly to help the president get reelected, to help keep the Senate in Republican control, and to try to retake the House. And it's all about turnout. The hard left is going to show up in crazy numbers. We've got to make sure everybody else shows up. And that's actually why I wrote the book, One Vote Away. You know, I wrote it this summer. And it was during COVID lockdown. I was at home in my living room. Obviously, I didn't know there'd be a Supreme Court vacancy in October. But I did know we had a presidential election in November. And in my view, the Supreme Court and protecting the Bill of Rights is the most important issue on the ballot. And so the book is designed to explain to people why that's the case, to take them inside. You know, before I was in the Senate, I was a Supreme Court litigator. My job was arguing cases in front of the U.S. Supreme Court. So each chapter of the book addresses a different constitutional liberty. There is a chapter on free speech, a chapter on religious liberty, a chapter on the Second Amendment, a chapter on democracy and elections. And every one of them, in the chapters, it's not academic or abstract. It's rather practical. I take the reader inside behind the curtain to understand what's happening at the Supreme Court. And I tell war stories about the major landmark decisions, many of which I help litigate personally. And it's designed to help, you know, for a lot of Americans, you look at the court, you know it's important, but it's kind of confusing. It's hard to understand what everything is about. This book is designed to be accessible, to be informative, to be interesting, to be fun. You don't have to be a lawyer to enjoy this book. And I'll say, Samantha, it's been incredible. The book won Vote Away. It is shot up to be the number one bestseller in the country on Amazon. And I think it is because people are hungry to understand really what's going on at the court, what the election is about. What are the stakes with the confirmation of Judge Barrett? And so I think in terms of turning voters out in November, the book One Vote Away is designed to help turn people out because, you know, let's say there's some voters out there, and I know there are, who for various reasons may not be fans of the president. There may be something he says or does they don't like. They don't like what he tweets. And so they're thinking, well, gosh, I don't know if I'm going to vote. I may stay home. I may just leave the presidential. If we do that, that's how the radicals take over. That's how Biden, Schumer, and Pelosi implement their radical agenda. And what this book is designed to do is to say, listen, I understand if you don't like everything the president says and tweets. I don't like everything the president says and tweets. But I'm not willing to destroy our right to free speech over it. I'm not willing to see our religious liberty rights taken away. I'm not willing to see the Second Amendment essentially erased from the Constitution. And so the book really explains what the stakes are for you, for your family. And I hope it helps, number one, turn people out to vote in November, but number two, to arm people as you're talking with your friends, your family, you're arguing and talking about the debates and the election and the confirmation. It gives you the information to make the argument and hopefully to move people's hearts and minds.
There's been some concern, and I want to get your take on this, that we might not know the election results when we head to bed on election night. And this has happened before with Bush v. Gore. What lessons from that case can be applied to 2020, and what should we be expecting on election day?
So I think there are a lot of lessons that can be taken from that. One of the chapters in the book is on democracy and elections, and it's on Bush versus Gore. So I was part of the legal team that represented George W. Bush. I was a young lawyer at the time, was working on the presidential campaign. Actually, I met my wife, Heidi, on the campaign. We were in cubicles about 20, 30 feet apart. And if you remember what happened in 2000, on election night, George W. Bush won. But the results in Florida were very, very close. And so Al Gore sent in an army of lawyers to challenge the outcome. And his lawyers were doing what lawyers do in any recount, which is they were trying to throw out votes for George W. Bush, and they were trying to find new votes for Al Gore to change the outcome. And so I flew to Florida. I was in Tallahassee in Florida for the entire recount. And, you know, it's interesting. Some of the books and some of the movies that have been made about Bush versus Gore afterwards, they sometimes paint it as this orchestrated strategic effort. None of that is true. It was utter and complete chaos. I remember the first 6 days I was there, I slept 7 hours. We had in the war room, we had a whiteboard on the wall. We had a chart of 7 different lawsuits that were pending, any one of which could cost the presidency of the United States. And the case went twice to the U.S. Supreme Court. The first time we won unanimously, 9-0. The Supreme Court agreed that the Florida Supreme Court, a partisan Democratic court, had gotten it wrong, vacated the decision and sent it back. The second time we went to the Supreme Court on the question of remedy, the outcome, the court divided 5-4, just one vote away. The court concluded, they said, the ballots have been counted 4 separate times in Florida. George W. Bush has won all 4 times. Enough is enough. Under the law, the election is over. That took 36 days. 36 days of chaos, of uncertainty, of nobody in the country or across the world knowing who the next president was. Now, I think what happened in Florida could happen in 2020, except on a much bigger scale. Instead of just one state, it could easily be two, three, four, five states. We could see litigation if they're close states across the country. We could see the Biden campaign filing litigation. We could see the Trump campaign filing litigation. We could see both filing litigation challenging various outcomes state by state. And that's one of the reasons why it is so important that we confirm Judge Barrett by Election Day. Because if you have multiple cases challenging the outcome of the election and nobody knows where it is, if there are only eight justices on the Supreme Court can divide 4-4, and an equally divided court has no legal authority to decide anything, which means we could have conflicting court of appeals decision and just months of uncertainty and chaos and constitutional crisis. I don't think the Senate should take that risk. I think we should ensure that there is a nine-justice functioning Supreme Court to resolve any litigation that arises and ensure that we follow federal law and follow the Constitution.
Now, Senator Cruz, I have one more question before you go. During a press conference on Thursday, Speaker Nancy Pelosi was asked about invoking the 25th Amendment.
Do you think it's time to invoke the 25th Amendment?
I'll talk to you about that tomorrow. I'll talk to you about it tomorrow. I'm not talking about it today, except to tell you, if you want to talk about that, we'll see you tomorrow.
What are your thoughts about the, you know, this conversation of potentially invoking the 25th Amendment?
Well, the nice thing is the speaker can talk about whatever she wants. She doesn't have the authority to do that under the Constitution that is given to the cabinet and the vice president. And it's only in cases of extraordinary medical incapacity. We get that the speaker hates Donald Trump. This is a speaker who, from the instant she's gotten the gavel, has opposed everything the president has done and started trying to impeach him the instant there was a Democratic majority. They're willing to abuse the Constitution to try to get Donald Trump out of office, and it's because they're angry at the American people for electing him in the first place. That kind of massive resistance, it may be good politics if you're on the far left, but it is utterly inconsistent with the Constitution. So it is not lost on anyone that she is going to try to attack the president, but I don't think that's what the American people are looking for in our leaders. They're looking for leaders who will actually work to address the enormous challenges we've got in this country. Look, we're dealing with a global pandemic that's cost over 200,000 lives in America. We're dealing with an economic catastrophe that was caused by the pandemic and the response we've taken to try to defeat that virus. And right now, Nancy Pelosi has no interest in working with anybody, Republicans or anyone else, to try to solve those economic problems, to try to get people back to work, to try to reopen businesses, to try to reopen schools. Instead, it's all partisan warfare all the time. And I don't think that's what the American people are looking for.
Well, Senator Ted Cruz, thank you so much for joining me today to speak about your new book, One Vote Away, How a Single Supreme Court Seat Can Change History. Thanks so much for joining me.
Thanks, Samantha. And let me encourage everyone, go to Amazon, go to Barnes & Noble, wherever you get your books. As I said, it became the number one bestseller in the country on Amazon, and I think it, I think you'll enjoy it. I think you'll find it fun, informative, and really timely for what's happening in the country right now.